Take my hands, they are yours to use. Take my feet, I will follow you. Fill my mouth, give me words to pray. Break my heart with what brings you pain. Here in this moment, I can hear your spirit call. So I'm coming as your servant, surrendering to you now. Here am I, send me. Here am I, send me. Savior, I'll take your message to the world. Here am I.
The king calls for you. The question in our topic is a question of all ages. Asked several thousand years ago to our forefather in the Garden of Eden, it is a question that still resonates throughout our hearing the world over. Told by your master then, it remains a question of accountability, a question of self-assessment, a question of personal reckoning, a question to foster self-reflection, and a call for the restoration of order. The pointed question of Adam, where art thou? In essence, is a question which typifies the male gender, Adam, and his absentee role in every sector of society. It is an inquiry that can well be conducted and stated in our homes, for often he cannot be found there. And even when he is there in body, he is absent in function and authority. The investigation can extend to our workplaces, where our brothers have become chauvinistic, lazy, and satisfied, and they have traded their zeal for self-improvement and to better off themselves to our sisters, feeling that they have earned the right to be the boss based solely on the fact that they are male. The question of Adam, where art thou, also echoes in the schools, in the colleges, and the universities of the world, where all males are overrun and outperformed by your ladies in the academic arena. And this question is obviously heard in the various congregations of our churches, where males are outnumbered by our ladies, show very little concern for leadership or spiritual growth and development, and are often totally uninvolved in the service of the Lord. The inquiry is troublesome. And so I ask, in light of the decay and the confusion in our societies where men are marrying men and women marrying women, and they say it's no problem, and people are so confused and totally fed up, I ask, men, where are you? Where are you? Where are you to take your rightful place as leaders, as prophets, as priests, and as kings? We are you in the scheme of things in this 21st century. We are you to champion the cause of our imprisoned youngsters which fill all of the jail cells the world over. We are you to be the example of what it actually means to be a real explain that the question, Adam, where art thou, is a question that goes beyond the means. And in fact, this question incorporates the female gender, the woman. For the name Adam was representative of all human beings, of humankind. Amen. This name was representative of the great grandfather of all humans. Amen. That is why one speaks of the Adamic nature in reference to sin. And this refers to both males and females, of course. Thus, the call is extended to every person who has been created by the great creator. Amen. It goes to every person who has once been exposed to fellowship and relationship with God. Every person who was once convicted by the power of God, but has become indecisive as to whether they should serve God wholeheartedly or not. This call extends to every person who may be hiding in the Eden of the church, hiding behind membership, hiding behind frequent attendance, hiding behind positions, hiding behind appointments, but are not in the right fellowship with God and therefore cannot function aright. The call is extended to every person who has been haunting between two opinions with regards to what God wants of their lives. Every person who is misplaced in Christendom, who has not yet found their place in the kingdom, the question echoes loudly, Adam, where art thou? We must understand that this extended question, Adam, where art thou, posed by our master, our father, our king, many years ago, was used in a strategic effort to restore fallen mankind to God's kingdom. It was a question that was designed to help humankind again to enjoy his presence. And this call for humans has never ceased. This very call was again exemplified in our text that was read just now, 2 Samuel chapter 9. And so, based on this passage, I have come to tell you, the king is calling for you. The king is calling for you. Could you tell somebody again that the king is calling for you? Oh, do it again. Tell somebody, the king is calling for you.
The king is calling for you.
Listen, you may have been hiding for a while. Like Adam in the Garden of Eden, huh? You may even feel naked, exposed, ashamed, and disappointed with yourself. But I came to tell you today that despite your challenges, despite your feelings, despite your past failure, despite your circumstances, despite the excuses that you may want to make, the king is calling for you and you must answer him. This was a situation for Mephibosheth. Mephibosheth, in our text, look at this situation. Not something that happens when the king calls for you. First of all, when the king calls for you, he overlooks who you are.
Yes. Amen.
He overlooks who you are.
Yes.
Some persons would like to make Christianity exclusive. Hello?
Yes.
Some people would want to have some celebrities. How many people know there are really no celebrities in Christianity?
Yes.
Hello? For all of us are level and right at the foot of the cross. Hello, I've done some funerals in my time, and all of them seem to go the same way. Hello? So when the king calls for you, as he is calling for you now, he overlooks who you are. He overlooks who you are. Some people, they tend to feel that for you to make it in life, you have son of a particular family.
Yes.
Hello?
Yes.
You have to have a particular title or surname or family background. Some people think that's the only way it can get you in life. But I'm glad for how Jesus did it. Jesus says that for God, that even the scripture says that God so loved the world that he gave his only begotten son so that whosoever, I'm glad that whosoever includes me. Aren't you happy that whosoever includes you? Anything extra. It's not a question of whether or not you have enough money to come. He overlooks who you are. And so, look at this. In the case of Mephibosheth, the king, when the king calls for you, he overlooks who you are. And he overlooks the fact that Mephibosheth was the son of the enemy. Are you with me?
Yes.
Mephibosheth was the son of the enemy. Now try to understand. When kings come to the throne in those days, one of the first thing they did was to kill every person who was a threat to their throne.
Yes.
Hello?
Yes.
If they didn't do it, they had the people who did it. So understand in our text, David is taking over from King Saul.
Yes.
He's taking over from King Saul. And King Saul would have sought to kill David several times.
Yes.
He would escape because God had his hand on David's life.
Amen.
And so, upon coming to the throne, the men would have carried out the process of killing all of the people.
Yes.
After killing all of the people, notice the first verse that was read in 2 Samuel 9. Is there anybody left? Anybody left of the family of David? To show kindness to him for my friend Jonathan's sake. Understand, Jonathan was David's friend, son of Saul, but very much in love with David. And he would have given him many secrets several times to protect him from the rage of his father. Are you with me? And so David is now coming to the throne and they kill all these people and they look around and then he said, wow, I had promised my friend Jonathan that I would look out for his people.
Yes.
Hello? And so he says, is there anybody left
yes.
from the house of Saul so that I can show some kindness to them?
Yes.
Hello?
Yes.
And here comes Mephibosheth was spoken of. Mephibosheth was the son of Jonathan. Hello? His friend?
Yes.
The grandson of Saul. Who was David's enemy?
Yes.
But this was overlooked when the king called him.
Yes.
My God!
Yes.
But this was overlooked, even though he was an enemy and perhaps a potential threat to the throne.
Yes.
Yet, David would call for him.
Yes.
Oh Lord. I want to tell you, not any text, but we too were sons of the enemy.
Yes.
You're not hearing me?
Yes.
We too were sons of the enemy when God called for us. When Satan was our dad.
Yes.
I know you're looking good now, and you're dressed up, and you're looking pretty, but hey, Satan was our father.
Yes.
Yes. Satan was our father. We were sons of Satan. We were enslaved by Satan. We were children of the devil. But although we were enemies to God, yet he called for us. Satan was the dead, shattered and burdened. We offered wholehearted service to him without reward. In fact, just like the children of Israel in Egypt, the more we work for the devil, the more he sought to punish us and despise us for our obedience to him. My God, what is it? Mankind is going to realize that the more we work for the devil, the more he seeks to do us harm. He's a wicked devil. Wicked fellow. He rewards you with
my God. And so, the more we work for him, the more we carried out his wicked plans, the more he sought to entrap us into evil and to see if we could wrap us up and tangle us up so that we make it to hell. Yet, in all of that state, when Jesus called for us, he overlooked our enslavement. He overlooked our sinful state. He freed us from the bondages of sin. Somebody needs to rejoice that right now, he has set us free. What some way to say, Jesus sets me absolutely free. He died upon the tree.
Saying that was our state. Oh Lord.
Every now and then somebody needs to remember and give a shout of thank you, Jesus. Somebody needs to remember and say thank you, Jesus. Oh Lord, it's no wonder that somebody said, you ought to have been there when the Lord saved me. You ought to be there. No, you ought to have been there when the Lord saved me. Some people say you're emotional. Some people say you're making noise. You ought to be there. You don't know a thing about what God did for me. You don't know what causes me to go crazy. As I go crazy, God set me free. that you are son of the enemy. He overlooks the fact that you are lame, incapacitated, and can't be of much in any kingdom. He called for you nonetheless. Hallelujah. 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 But note another thing. Note another thing. When the king calls for you secondly, I want to suggest that he overlooks where you are. He overlooks where you are. Some of us were buried in sin. Some of us were lost, so lost. As we sang, so lost. Without God, we were so lost. Caught up in so many things. But when the king calls for you, he overlooks where you are. Hallelujah. The text we read just now said that Mephibosheth was in the house of Micah. Hello? He was in the house of Micah. Micah means sold. Hello? The meaning of the term Micah is sold. In other words, Mephibosheth was sold out. Hello? Sold out of society. Sold out. He was in the house of Micah. He was in the house of Saul. Away from his rightful place in the kingdom. Are you hearing me? Away from the presence of the king. Sold out. This reminds me of our state. We too were sold out. Sold out to the enemy of our souls. Sold out. Away from the presence of the king. Away from the presence of his kingdom. Sold out to the world. We were sold out. Just like Mephibosheth. We were in the house of Micah. Yet, he overlooked where we were. He summons us into his presence and into his kingdom. And today, he doesn't mind where you are hiding. He only bids you come. He said, come out. Come out from in the garden of Eden. Come out from wherever you are. Come out and come to my table. Come to my kingdom. Come into my presence. He doesn't care where you are. He calls for you. He says, come. Come into my kingdom. Come into my presence. Come into those provisions I have made for you. You have played second-class citizen for too long. Come into the king's palace. Come at his table. Receive what he has prepared for you. Calling for you. The king is calling for you. Go somebody praise God. That he's calling for us. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Jesus. I'm saying, when the king calls for you, he overlooks where you are. In the house of Micah, in the house of Saul, they are sold out. But the fact that he overlooks the fact that you are in Lodibar. Lodibar was a ghetto. Are you hearing me? Lodibar was a Bible time ghetto. A place which literally means lacking in pasture. It was an unproductive place. A place which hosted social outcasts. The noise of society was in Lodibar. And so, this brother Mephibosheth, because of his incapacitation, couldn't use his legs. He figured, wow, they're killing all those cousins. They're killing all my relatives. Let me go to a place that I won't think about. A place where I deserve. I'll go to Lodibar. Ghetto. Unproductive place. Noise of society. Huh? In fact, you know what would further qualify bowed down because he thought the king was going to kill him. He bowed down, he was afraid. And when the king said, "Oh, I called you here because I'm going to bless you," he said, "What do you have to do with a dog like me? Such as I. Lodibar was his place of residence. Hey, but such was our state. Such was our state. We were in the ghetto of sin. We were in our Egypt land, lacking in productivity, smelly in degradation. Hello? We were social outcasts from the commonwealth of Israel, outside the waters of reconciliation. We were beaten up with sin, good for nothing. We were lost and untimely. But Jesus, by his Holy Ghost, he drew us unto the Father.
Thank you.
wants for you, he sets out to favor you. Lord Jesus. Lord Jesus. I tell God, did you see Mephibosheth? Read over the passage when you go home, 2 Samuel 9. It's a short passage. Notice Mephibosheth. He expected nothing. In fact, he expected death. But he positioned himself right. He bowed down, expecting to be harmed by the king. But thank God for mercy. Mercy said no. Thank God for mercy. He bowed himself, expecting to receive the death sentence. And even when the king said, no, I brought you here because I'm going to bless you. I'm going to put you to my table. I'm going to have you here for the rest of your life. He said, what do you see on a dog like I that you should want to do this? But the king is different. When the king calls for you, he sets out to favor you. Sets up to favor you. As King David did for Mephibosheth, King Jesus wants to do it for you. Are you hearing me today? As King David did for Mephibosheth, King Jesus wants to do the same for you. He wants to bring you into his kingdom. He wants to bring you into his presence. He wants to lavish you with all of his favors. Are you hearing me? He wants to just favor you. He wants to just lavish you with all his favor. He wants to improve your standard of living. He's coming for you for a purpose. He's calling for you for a purpose. The purpose is that he wants to favor you. He wants to favor you. Oh Lord, he sets out to favor you. He also sets out to honor you. Are you hearing me, church? He wants to honor you. Mephibosheth was given the privilege of eating at the king's table for the rest of his life. This is the privilege and the honor that God wants to bestow upon us. Some of us, we've been serving the Lord for a long time, yet we are like beggars. Are you hearing me? Scarcely understanding what the king demands of us. Scarcely understanding the privileges we have of feasting at the king's table. But the king calls for you today, and he wants to do exactly for you what King David did for Mephibosheth. He wants to honor you. He wants to seat you at his table to enjoy his regular feast. He wants you to be above mediocrity and above the petty. He wants to establish you above your competition. He wants to place you in a good place, in a safe place. He wants to promote you. He wants to make you the head and not the tail. He wants you to be first and not last. He wants you to excel in all that you do. He wants that everything you put your hand to, you are blessed. He says, come, come, come to my kingdom. Come to my presence. Come to my table. I have great things in store for you. He wants to honor you. He wants to honor you. But he first wants you to answer the question. We are down. For he wants you to come to grips with your spiritual position. Hello? You can't go forward except you know where you are. You need to know where you are so that you can make progress. Hello? And the question of Adam, we are down, is a question of self-assessment. Where am I in the scheme of things? Where am I positioned in the kingdom of God? Am I where God wants me to be?
He wants us to come to grips
with
our spiritual position.
And so
today I'm saying,
for I see by the celebration,
the King is calling
for you. Father, hear me pray.